care and concern for you. We know that there are a lot of things out there that are pressing upon you and causing stress and causing you to make decisions. Today is not a time for us to tell you guys what to do. It's just an opportunity to give you information to make choices that are going to push you in a positive direction. Anytime that we have a guest here, it's a great opportunity to demonstrate what it means to be an LTTV, so we appreciate in advance your respect for our speaker, as well as our students who are going to be asking some of your questions. Just to give you kind of an idea of what we're going to do today, once I'm done here, Dr. Waterman wanted to be at both campuses, but obviously he can't be at two places at the same time, so we're going to listen to an introduction to him because this is very important to him, as well as the entire LTTV community. So we'll listen to a few words from Dr. Waterman. I'll introduce our speaker, and then we'll have an opportunity to answer some of the questions that you guys submitted, because this assembly for you is for you, is to give you guys information for the questions that you have. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Waterman.
Happy New Year, LT. We hope that the first few weeks of the semester are off to a great start and that you're well on your way towards accomplishing all the goals that you set out for yourself at the beginning of the school year. Traditionally, when we gather together in the field house, it's for positive reasons. Whether we are honoring our veterans in November, celebrating a state championship, highlighting the academic achievements at our end of the year awards assemblies, or highlighting the musical talents of our students, we always value the importance of being together and celebrating who we are as a school community. Today is a little bit different. We are here today because we are concerned, and we are here today because we care. We are hosting student assemblies at both campuses at the same time in order to have an honest conversation about vaping and e-cigarette usage. It's no secret that the use of vape pens and e-cigarettes have significantly increased over the last few years. And we think it's important to share the latest science behind vaping, hear about the effects of vaping on our bodies, and to answer some questions that you, our students, have about vaping and e-cigarettes. We don't believe for a second that one student assembly will convince every student who is vaping to quit. We do believe that today is one small part of an effort not to tell you what to do, but to work with you to reverse this dangerous trend. And I believe that this is a responsibility that we all share. As always, we ask for the traditional LT respectfulness that you exhibit when we are together in the field house. And again, we are concerned about this topic, but most importantly, we care about your short-term and your long-term health and safety. We hope that today's assembly is informative, and we wish everyone an outstanding second semester. Thank you.
And by the way, in the back, can you guys hear me okay up at the top? Somebody give me a good? Okay, good. Louder. Also, please, right up front, please don't take this. I know working with teens, I've been working with teens. Luckily, my kids aren't teens yet. I know that telling teens what to do, it doesn't work. So like Dr. Waterman said in the video, right up front, I'm not trying to tell you what to do. You guys make your own decisions, whether you think it's a good idea, bad idea, never gonna do it, whatever. I just wanna give you information that I've found through some of my own research and other things that I've found through my own work with teens. Please just incorporate this information into your decision making on whether you decide to try one of these devices or continue to use one of these devices on an ongoing basis. Just put it in there with other information that you've gathered and make that decision for yourself. So I'm not telling you what to do. Obviously, you know what I'm going to talk about is going to be primarily the negative effects. You know that. But I never want you to perceive it as like, well, he's telling us what we have to know. You make your own decision, okay? But I do want to make sure you have good information, because when I first started talking about this a year or two ago, I used the term misinformation. But what I've realized more and more is that I don't think it's necessarily you guys are getting bad information. I think in a lot of ways you don't have enough, that you're not getting much information at all. That a lot of kids just think of, you know, I'll talk a little bit about the term vaping, vapor. A lot of kids are just thinking of flavor humidifier air. Nicotine, maybe nicotine, maybe not, and really not thinking much further than that. What I would ask you to be is a little bit more informed or wise about the fact that it might be a little bit more complicated or nuanced than that, okay? So I'm gonna just go through some slides in the background. A lot of you guys are probably familiar with this in terms of what vaping is. Short for vaporizing, heating usually liquid up to the point where it's not smoke, it's not combustion, it's not fire, but it's releasing chemicals. You guys know all that, right? But I think an important point when we talk about vaping is, they used to be called e-cigarettes. How many of you in the past 6 months or a year have even heard the term from other peers, e-cigarette? Anybody? Okay. How many have heard the term vaping? Yeah, everybody's afraid to put their hand up if they think there's somebody who's seen it. I'm not talking about humans, someone else, right? So a lot more hands went up when I talked about vaping, right? The term e-cigarette has kind of transitioned in the past couple years to vaping. Now, I wish they were still called e-cigarettes. Why do I wish they were still called e-cigarettes? Because the term vaping relates to the downform vapor, right? When you think of vapor, most people think of humidifiers, right? They think of steam coming out of a boiling pot of water. They think of water mist. And I think it can be very easy for someone your age to hear that term and be walked down the path of thinking that, hey, this really isn't that big a deal. But it's actually what you're inhaling is actually more of an aerosol. So it's actually more similar in terms of the number of chemicals and the consistency of it. It's much more similar to what comes out of a can of hairspray or Febreze. It's obviously not the same chemicals. I'm not trying to mislead you. But it's similar in terms of its consistency to that. Now, do you think as many kids would do it if it was called aerosol, right? Versus if it was called vaping. So don't be misled by that term vaping. And I'll talk a little bit about what's in the aerosol or vapor. So I want to talk about the FDA or Food and Drug Administration for a second, because I think I always get questions about, well, why is this happening? If there's all these chemicals in it, why don't we know? And why are there more tests and all of these types of questions? Because you have to understand that this is a whole industry that's more or less simply built off of making money, using your kind of susceptible teen brains as a way to make money, get addicted, have somebody as a nicotine or marijuana consumer for life, right? Unfortunately, the regulation of these devices has lagged behind this industry that's now making huge billions and billions of dollars, primarily off of your teenage brains, right? They see your brains as dollar signs. Please realize that all of the marketing, and you guys, I think, are wise enough to know that with how sleek and discreet the jewel is, how easy it is to, you know, put in a sleeve, put on a shirt, you know, all the flavors, very difficult to detect. All these things you guys know well about, I think you're wise enough to know who these companies are targeting with all of these different components of it. So the FDA, or Food and Drug Administration, they do make the companies that produce these devices, they do make them disclose what's in the liquids that are in the devices. But here's the main problem with that, and I want to make sure you're aware of this, because you might say, okay, well, hang on, there's only glycerin, you know, propylene glycol, maybe some flavor, nicotine typically. And you might say, okay, there's only 4, 5, 6 ingredients in this thing. How could it really be that bad? And it kind of reinforces that misconception of it being like that humidifier where you see just a handful of ingredients, you know, vegetable, which, you know, similar to kind of like vegetable oil. But the problem with that is that really is almost irrelevant. You're not inhaling the liquid, right? Hopefully not. You're doing it wrong if you're inhaling the liquid, by the way. It's just like what's important is what's getting released in the aerosol or the vapor. Okay, and so I want to focus mostly on that. If there's one slide, if you guys are falling asleep, if there's one slide you're going to pay attention to, it's the next one. Now, here's what a lot of kids say to me. They say, well, it's not as bad as cigarettes. Is that true? Kind of, yeah. Right? Because you're eliminating a lot of the carcinogens that get emitted through smoke. So because it's not, there's no combustion, there's no smoke, in reality, you are eliminating a lot of the carcinogens. That's true. But please don't go from one extreme to the other thinking just because you're removing a lot of the carcinogens that all of the carcinogens are being removed, because that's just not the truth. And I love that you guys have, in the bathroom right outside here, you guys have a poster that kind of highlights the chemicals that are in there. I think the issue is, I can see somebody seeing that poster and saying, well, it's saying all these chemicals are in there, but I know, I can read the box and it says in the liquid there's only these 4 or 5 ingredients. Please realize when it gets heated, a whole chemical process occurs and there's a whole bunch of chemicals that get released through that process. There's 42 different known chemicals that get released when, in the case of a nicotine vape, when it gets heated up, there's about 42 chemicals get released. And these are some of the ones that I wanted to highlight. And I'm guessing most or all of you probably didn't know that these chemicals are getting released through that aerosol, through that vapor. The interesting thing to me is that, and I'll, you guys in the back probably can't see this very well, so I apologize for it, but the irony in this is the chemicals in blue, the acetone, the benzene, the cadmium, the lead, the aldehyde, the toluene, those are also in cigarettes. So I find it interesting when I ask kids, I say, do you guys smoke cigarettes? And they say, oh, no, bro, you know, you probably hear this a lot. No, most people you don't probably don't even smoke cigarettes. But then I'll ask them, well, have you ever tried a vape? Sure, I've tried it. And I think there's a disconnect. Most kids are not understanding that there's still a lot of the same chemicals that have been released through that process. Yes, they're not all there. There are a lot that are removed, but please don't have that black and white thinking of thinking just because it's not the same chemicals as cigarettes, they're all being removed. But I don't know if you can see this, but look at some of the chemicals that are in there. Formaldehyde, you guys are probably familiar with formaldehyde, it's been being embalming fluid. Cadmium, which is car batteries, benzene, which is pesticides and gas. Toluene, which is a poison industrial solvent. Lead, there can even be nickel and tin that comes to these devices, particularly if they're overheated. Because there's a metal heating element that heats the liquid that has nickel and tin in it, and some of that nickel and tin can go into that aerosol that gets inhaled, particularly if somebody isn't familiar with using it and it gets overheated, like I said. Diacetyl my understanding is that they're starting to remove it from vapes, but at the same time, some of the more recent studies have shown that there's still this flavor agent called diacetyl in a lot of vapes, which is associated with a medical condition called popcorn lung. Has anybody here heard of popcorn lung here? Okay, that means this is good. It means the word's getting out. Although it might have been your parents putting an article in front of you, right? You probably don't want to hear that. The medical term for popcorn lung is called Bronchiolitis obliterans. What does obliterans sound like? Does that sound like any word that you know? Obliterate, right? So that shows you how bad this condition can be. I won't give you the whole story about how the term popcorn lung came from a doctor that worked near my toy popcorn factory in Missouri. Workers were coming in with really significant lung damage. Found it was they were inhaling this diacetyl, this flavoring agent. I'm glad to hear that there's the idea of removing this chemical from these veins because it's associated with this medical condition. But at the same time, do you know that? If you guys have tried to vape, do you know for sure that diacetyl wasn't in there? Do you know for sure what you were inhaling in that aerosol? Or did you look and do some research to say, well, this is what's in the liquid, so it can't be that bad? Make sure you know. I know this might sound obvious, but I think a lot of kids, make sure you know what you're inhaling. It's kind of important, right? Make sure you're aware of this. It's critical, I think, in terms of being aware of it. Now, this whole industry that's exploding is relying on this concept as a way to get teenagers hooked on these devices. And you probably know people that are hooked on these devices. But real nicotine addiction is a real thing. It's one of the most addictive drugs. You probably have heard that. But I think it's important to emphasize that now, where there's been kind of a resurgence in nicotine use through vapes, is that in a chart of drug addiction, in terms of what's the most addictive drugs, nicotine is always in that top right corner of that chart, up there with cocaine and heroin. Not as destructive, not as life-destructing, but it's just as addictive. So we're seeing kids like you've probably seen that are getting this obsessive mentality about their vapes because they really are getting addicted to the nicotine. And a lot of that is based on brain development. If your brains are particularly susceptible to addiction, getting hooked on these devices. Not only that, but by using devices, you're impairing the development of particularly the prefrontal cortex, that front part of the brain that's responsible for planning, decision making, all these important executive functionings. So this industry knows this. If we're going to get somebody hooked, the best time to get them started is in that 12 to 18 year old range, because that's when your brains are susceptible and vulnerable to that addiction. So be aware of that. Again, I can't emphasize that enough, that this industry is built on grabbing you guys and basically taking your money over the next, in their perspective, over the next hopefully 30, 40, 50 years before you get, you know, lung cancer, whatever the case may be. So dabs, I think talking about vaping, I do have to talk about marijuana, dabs, all these terms that you guys are familiar with, I'm sure. Because as I'm sure you're noticing, we're seeing these devices as well that have marijuana in them. And I think one of the main thing I want to point out when it comes to marijuana is I hear all the time kids will say, well, marijuana is not as bad as alcohol, it's not as bad as cigarettes. We're in this era now where marijuana is regarded as medicine. It's legal in a lot of states. It might end up being legal in Illinois in the near future. But please don't confuse something being legal with it being safe for teenagers to use. Now, I know the law isn't the best, always the best deterrent, but please keep in mind, because we're getting this argument from kids that we're working with that are telling their parents, well, weed's gonna be legal anyway, so it's okay. I hope you're not using that as an argument when in fact a teenager using marijuana is particularly detrimental. And I actually think when compared to nicotine or alcohol, from the research I've seen, that marijuana is actually, in my mind, more harmful to brain development. When you talk about all these really important parts of the brain, the hippocampus, the amygdala, nucleus, the complex hypothalamus, when you're talking about memory, managing emotion and anxiety, motivation. And what's interesting is, in 15 plus years of working with teens, and a lot of these are teens that, that use marijuana on a regular basis, I've always seen the same symptoms over and over and over again. And maybe if you know somebody that uses marijuana on a regular basis, you've seen this as well. What do I see? I see lack of motivation, I see memory problems, I see dysregulation with mood, dysregulation with managing anxiety. So the symptoms I've seen match perfectly with the brain development that's being impaired. We're not just talking about brain chemistry, we're also talking about, like, these are actual physical regions, like in pea size or almond shape, physical bodies in your brain, where would they do studies on teens that use marijuana and teens that don't. The teens that use marijuana, particularly regularly, these parts of the brain are actually smaller, they're misshapen, they're less dense. So it's actually affecting the physical growth of these critical parts of your brain that are developing, as you probably know at this point, till about the age of 25 or 30. So your brain's like wet cement, like a house being constructed, whatever metaphor works for you. And by using any of these drugs, nicotine, marijuana, alcohol, you're messing with that very important time of development up until the age of about 25. Something I get all the time when it comes to marijuana is I get, well, man, states are legalizing it. You got the whole country of Canada legalizing it, right? I know you guys have noticed that. I'm sure you have. But it's important to understand that these states that have legalized it haven't legalized it because they came to some moral epiphany, some moral wisdom about the benefit or harmlessness of marijuana that states like Illinois or other states that haven't done that. It's about tax revenue. It's about money. It's a money-making industry. So it's important. Yeah, there is some tax revenue that comes from it, but I think it's important because now marijuana has been legal in Colorado, I think, for about 5 years. That we're starting to see over these past 4 or 5 years that there's a lot of bad things that are happening in the state that maybe don't get talked about or you guys might not be aware of that are related to legalization of marijuana. You might say, well, why, if these things are true, why would Illinois be considering legalizing it? That's a great question. I asked that question myself. But you have to realize that there's all these industries, these multi-billion dollar industries behind the scenes that are lobbying, that are entwined with our governing officials to move forward with legislation that will push forward this multi-billion dollar industry that's really built, again, on teenagers and young people starting to use these. So please don't fall prey to this industry that's really just looking at your brains as dollar signs. So if you look at, you might not be able to see this, so I'll mention a couple of them in terms of what's happened in Colorado. This is the high intensity drug trafficking study from Colorado. And again, one thing I want to mention too, before I lose track of time here, any of this information I'm presenting to you, do your own research. But if you're going to Google is vaping harmful, right, be very leery of the order of the searches that come up. Because this industry is pumping a lot of money into getting their searches, because you can pay Google to have your name. You guys ever Google and you see where's this ad, it takes you a while to get a scroll down. Be aware that when you Google search this stuff, which is how everybody does their research, that's how I do my research, be very careful of the sites that you're looking at. Because I've worked with kids that are showing me articles on the phone, see Matt, Harvey's, or maybe it's not that important. And I say, well, scroll to the bottom, and it's, you know, hightimes.com. You know, you have to be very careful with your source. Be very mindful. Make sure it's a research institution, a hospital, or a research university. And certainly you want to be aware of funding. Funding's important. Check where the research is funded from. If it's funded from the tobacco industry, the marijuana industry, they're probably going to pull, it's maybe not going to be balanced research. So make sure the information you're getting is coming from a source that's credible and reliable. What's interesting to me is that 65% of local jurisdictions, in other words, towns in Colorado, will ban both the medical and recreational sale of marijuana. Did you know that? 65% of towns in Colorado have said, we don't want it. We don't want not only medicinal, we don't want recreational marijuana sold in our town. What does that tell you? These are towns that are circled by other areas that sell it, and they're saying, we don't want it in our community. That's important for you guys to be aware of. That's important for you to know. Tax revenue, because they hear all the time, well, this will help with Illinois', you know, budget crisis, tax issue. It's 1%. It's like 9 or 1.1, but I round it off. It's 1% of the tax revenue in Colorado's budget. So anybody that thinks that the tax revenue in Illinois is going to provide all the, you know, it's going to fix all the highways and all the spud, all the schools, it's just not accurate. It's just not enough money. It will provide some tax revenue, but it's a drop in the bucket relative to all the other tax revenue and the overall budget. So that's something to keep in mind. 52% increase in emergency department rates. A lot of those are children or teens that are eating edibles, using high potency dabs, high concentrates. They don't know what they don't realize the potency. They're passing out, they're having psychotic episodes. 52%, that's a big increase in emergency department visits. Traffic deaths have jumped up 151%. And I wanted to make sure, related to marijuana, I wanted to make sure to put up the overall, because there has been a 35% overall increase in traffic deaths in Colorado. Because I didn't want you to say, well, how do you know that it's related to marijuana? So when you talk about 151% versus 35%, that's a huge disparity. And that goes to show you that since it's been legalized, way more people are driving high, driving stoned. Because I've noticed working with a lot of teens, there's a misconception. I will say, I'll give you guys credit as teens, that teens nowadays, young people nowadays, are much better about not getting in a car with somebody who has been drinking. Your generation has done a fantastic job with that. But I'll say, in a lot of instances, there's a misperception of marijuana and driving is safe. And this statistic goes to show you that it's not. That there's similar impairment in peripheral vision, hand-eye coordination. So please don't fall prey to that misperception. As you guys move to, some of you probably have your permits, I don't know if you guys are old enough yet to have your license, but please be aware that driving while high, being safe, is a misconception. Violent crimes increase, property crimes have increased. So when it comes to marijuana in Colorado, I don't mind you having this vision of this kind of utopia or, you know, perfect world where it's been legalized and everything's great. There's a lot of downfalls, there are a lot of problems that come from that. Now, another thing that I get, I want to keep track of my time here. I can't see that clock over there. So another thing that I'm getting regarding marijuana is, man, it's a plant. It's natural. It comes from the earth. Okay. It's a plant. Agreed. But using that argument in my mind really doesn't hold much water if that's going to be your main argument for why it's safe. Because a lot of the deadliest poisons in the world come from plants. When you talk about ricin, hemlock, oleander. Not only that, but these hard drugs that kids often say, and appropriately say, cocaine, heroin, they say, I never touched those in a way that destroys your life, addiction, all of those things. Those come from plants too. So please be aware of the idea of something being natural, being from a plant. Give it some context. Make sure you give it the appropriate context and realizing that there's more to the story than just it being a plant, it being natural, it being safe. Okay. So I know I've touched on this already, but I want to come back to it. Most addiction happens when people start using under the age of 21, under the age of 18. If people, let's say with alcohol, if young people delay alcohol use until the age of 21, the legal drinking age, overwhelmingly, those people do not go on to develop alcoholism or other significant drug issues. Why? Because of that developing brain. Because when you're a teenager, I don't know if anybody, if you guys have like an intro psychology class here at all, But there's this thing called the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right? And up right up at the top is food, water, shelter, right? When you're a teenager, your brain is still adaptable in terms of what's going to get slotted into that hierarchy of needs. Or in other words, what's needed for survival. So if you start drinking, if you start vaping, you start using marijuana, other drugs, those drugs can start to fit in between or above even things like water, food, shelter over time, and can start to get locked in as being something that your brain interprets as being a need for survival. And that's how addiction develops, is the brain is tricking the person into thinking they need that, like they need water or food. But if someone, let's say, delays, and I'm not encouraging you guys when you're 21 to just start drinking, that's not what I'm saying, but I'm saying, if somebody delays, let's say alcohol use till the age of 21, at that point that hierarchy of needs is more or less set in stone. So that alcohol isn't going to be able to move above food or water in terms of being recognized as a need. And that's why it's so important at your age to avoid those things, so the brain can have a proper understanding of need and what the difference is between needs and wants. So every year younger that somebody starts using, the higher it goes up about 5% every year in terms of the chance of developing a more significant substance use issue. So if you in your mind are saying, you know what, I know it's at some point when I'm older I'm going to try drinking, okay? The biggest thing I can encourage you to do, aside from never drinking, is to wait. Wait for your brain to appropriately develop, and all those little size and all the chain parts of your brain to develop appropriately so that you have the appropriate awareness of what's needed and what's not needed. So we're going to transition into some questions here in a couple minutes. We have a couple students that are going to ask some questions that I can answer. But before we do that, I did want to mention a couple things. I didn't want to forget to mention, I believe the school tomorrow is participating in something, I think it's called the NIDA Live Chat, the National Institute on Drug Abuse. They're having something called Live Chat, where they're having schools around the country, students from different schools, being able to participate live. If you have questions for the National Institute, their scientists, their researchers, whether it's regarding vaping or other drugs, I would encourage you to, whether it's through your teacher or one of the assistant principals, forever, to participate in this, kind of take this a step further and participate in this live chat tomorrow through NIDA for the Institute of Drug Abuse and further your knowledge on this subject or other subjects. So I did want to mention Rosecrans because that's the organization that I do work for, and we specialize in treating both teens and adults that might be struggling with substance abuse issues, mental health issues. And I did want to mention that we have an office just a few minutes away right here at LaGrange where we offer free assessments. We also have early intervention classes, other outpatient services. So I did want to mention this, just in case you or somebody, another student, you feel like it's developing or it's progressing and you're worried about them. I did want to make sure that you or the other student has that opportunity to get a free assessment, get a free evaluation, to determine what support you might need in order to deal with whatever you're dealing with. So I wanted to make sure to mention that to you. This is just a picture. We also have a residential facility about an hour away in Rockford as well. Now, these are some of the sources that I pulled a lot of this information from. Again, sources that I was really careful about getting the information from. Certainly, I'd be happy to share. If you want these sources to be able to do your own research, I'd be happy to get it to you through your teachers or any other. Just reach out and they can get back hold of me. I'd be happy to share this. Do your own research. But please, if you think it's just humidifier air, mango, mint, whatever, 7,000 flavors, creme brulee, peaches and cream, it's pretty crazy all the flavors that are out there. If you think it's just flavor and humidifier, please realize that there's more to the story. And that's really all I wanted to do. It's just provide you with more information for you to take in, to to your decision making, whether to try one of these devices, whether to continue to use these. I wanted you to just take this information in, and whether you want to take it in and just spit it back out, that's up to you. But just hear it and think about it and incorporate it into the decision that you guys are making moving forward. So, is it James and Lily? So, two of them are going to, I think, alternate, or they're going to, they have...
Purchase a stake in Paxlabs, who's the company that makes
Juul. This just happened in the past month or two. What's interesting to me is that now big tobacco is recognizing the game isn't in cigarettes, it's in vapes, right? What's interesting to me is that there were people within the organization, within Juul, that didn't like the idea of being affiliated with big tobacco because it gets associated with cigarettes and that whole industry that's been around for 100 years. So what they did is, every employee, because we're talking about $4+ billion in this minority purchase of the company, they gave every employee, can you imagine this? Try to put yourself in this position if you were an employee of a company. Some of you might have part-time jobs. They gave every employee over $1 million, each employee. Now that's one way to get that to go along with this purchase, right? You might say, how can they afford that? Because you're talking about a $4+ billion. If you do the math, $1 million for a handful of employees isn't that much. But it just goes to show you this is big money. And that's really, this is just money and profit and all about making money for an industry that doesn't really care about you or your brains or your futures or addiction or any of that stuff. They're just trying to make money. Yeah, next question.
Why aren't there more commercials aired on TV to inform the public of the dangers associated with vaping?
Good question. I think you're going to start to see more commercials and more campaigns. I think the problem is that awareness, regulation, because you guys are young. Sometimes when I do this presentation to parents or school staff, the first slide I'll show will be a dog chasing its tail in a circle, because in counseling, in teaching, we're always kind of lagging a little bit behind. You know, when I first started hearing about Juul a couple of years ago, kids were looking at me like, you don't know about this? I'm like, no, I don't know about this. Because you guys are aware, much more aware of what's new, what's current than we are, you know that. So I think, unfortunately, our awareness, the regulatory bodies, the FDA's awareness of this, has lagged to the point where it's been a year or two where this has taken off. And unfortunately, a lot of this has gotten to the point where it's a huge problem now. And we're trying to, I think, as counselors, as treatment agencies, as regulatory bodies, trying to now address this in a way. So the honest answer to that is we've just been behind in terms of being able to address this. But I'm starting to see more and more YouTube videos, other advocacy, other nonprofits, other advocacy groups, other campaigns that are coming out. So I think over the next year plus, you're going to start to see more of that. The honest answer is just, I think a lot of us, up until the past 6 months or a year, weren't really aware of how bad it got in terms of how many kids were starting to do this stuff.
And our final question is just, how high is the risk of cancer for vaping? And do you know what kinds of cancer you can get?
Sure. So this is another question where I don't want to mislead people, because the reality of it is a device like Juul is relatively new, a couple of years, right, 2 or 3 years old. There's really no long-term, there's not enough long-term research. There's no 5, 10, 15, 20-year studies on what the Juul or some of these newer vaping devices, what it does to long-term health. I have talked to teams that have talked about if they use them regularly, where if they're in a sport, they start to notice almost kind of like asthma type symptoms, emphysema type symptoms, and they're wondering what's wrong. They think they have an allergy or asthma or something, and they put two and two together and realize that it's the vaping that's causing them to struggle a little bit with their cardiovascular endurance. But really the long-term impact is still not yet known. In terms of cancer, you guys are the guinea pigs, so welcome to the lab. But when you look at all those chemicals, when you look at that popcorn lung, ask yourself, do I want to participate in this experiment? Do I want to be part of this kind of in real-time research that's going to come out in 10, 15, 20 years? Do I want to be part of a cited research study that's talking about the long-term impact of that? Just ask yourself that, because that's where we're at right now. You guys are the lab getting fixed with this. And unfortunately, we don't have a lot of the long-term studies. Certainly we do with cigarettes, And if you look at the fact that some of the same chemicals are in cigarettes that are in these devices, you can probably make the same assumption that over the long run, using these devices, it's going to have an increase in lung cancer and other cancers. But is it 75% the risk of cigarettes? Is it 50%, 25%? We don't know that, because we just don't have the long-term research to know that. So I know that's not a satisfying answer, but that's already the reality of the world we live in, is we just don't have the benefit of having the time and the research to back that up. But we have enough in terms of some of those, like I said, asthma-type symptoms, emphysema-type symptoms, the popcorn lung, the blood uritis obliterans. I'm starting to hear stories from different schools. One of the social workers at St. Charles North High School, where I do some work, told me that there was a 17-year-old that got diagnosed with this popcorn lung, which surprised me, because quite honestly, I wasn't expecting those type of diagnoses to come until maybe late teens or 20s. But keep that in mind, that's anecdotal. I don't have any research, that's a story, right? And sometimes stories can tell a ton. So please realize, this might be, in terms of developing significant, particularly lung damage, it might be more harmful than you realize in more of a, you know, 3, 4, 5 year window. If you're thinking, well, I'll quit it in a year, 2 years, there might be already some significant lung damage that's being done if we're starting to hear these stories about kids that are developing these significant lung issues just within a year or two of use of these devices. So I don't know where we're at in time. I think we're pretty close. Maybe we might have maybe 5 minutes left-ish, somewhere in that neighborhood. But how much time do we have? Because I don't know if I should open it up to any more. 4 minutes, okay. So I did want to thank you guys. You guys have been a great audience, other than a little
today's success. We care about you, and we want you to be able to make the choices that are going to